Glory to God. Bless you. Let's get to work. Thank you. Thank you. We got about 15 minutes. I got to be real quick. George here with his baby. Oh, my gosh. I don't even know how to. I really do need some supernatural power right now. Amen. Let's go to let's go to scripture, Dre. Amen. 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 Jim, we on? Glory to God. Bless you, YouTube. Bless you, e-church. Bless you, internet. You know what? Let me tell you guys something. We got a family. I just got to testify about this family. We got an e-church family, right? And I was telling Eric about it a little bit. But we got an e-church family that's been with me from day one. They love us. They just want to do church internet. But they're so committed, right, that they're in Hawaii right now. And I guarantee you they're on internet right now. They're on vacation, but they're on internet at church right now, right? That's how committed they are. God bless you, Chelsea and Dave. God bless you. Hallelujah. The Bible says, and when you pray, you shall pray and not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the corners of the streets that they may be seen by men. And, you know, want to be seen. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. But you, when you pray, go into your room, and when you have shut your doors, pray to your Father who is in secret place, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. And when you pray, do not use vain repetitions as the heathens do, for they pray that they will be heard for their many words. Therefore, do not be like them, for your Father knows the things that you have need of before you ask him. And in this manner, therefore, pray like this, he said, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Mm-hmm. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Jesus said, but if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. Help me preach this quick message today. I think I might be a little late today. That gonna be all right, ma'am? Can I take a look? All right. Help me preach this message. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Uh-uh. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
How is your prayer life? Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. You know what? I hear the Holy Spirit. Wait a minute. Yes, Father. I hear the Holy Spirit saying, Dre, can you find James chapter 5? I hear the Holy Spirit saying something. James chapter 5, verse 14 through 16. James, ain't that where it says if you find elders, call on the elders to pray? Is that 5:14 through 16? James chapter 5. I just hear the Holy Spirit. I got to obey. Take us to James chapter 5. I think it's 14 through 16. Joe, can you come up here? Nate, Eric, Zach, come here. Please. Read that scripture, Nate. Boldly.
The Bible says, is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And if the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up, and if he has committed sin, he will be forgiven.
I believe my Bible. Amen. I hear the Holy Spirit. I hear the Holy Spirit saying for me to call these elders. These are my ministers. They're the elders to me. They hold me up. I need y'all to be quick. Don't pray like the vain people like we just talked about, the vain hypocrites. Don't be the hypocrite up here in repetition. Let's pray. Let's get this thing done. Hey, Shatadaba. Let's get this thing done.
Father God, we come to you right now in the name of Jesus.
In Jesus' name.
By the power of your Holy Spirit. Spirit, Lord, that you said that your word is true, Lord, so we call down upon the truth of your word.
Yes.
That you said if the elders were to come together and to anoint the man in oil,
yes,
not only would he be healed, but he would be forgiven of his sins.
Yes, Lord.
We stand on that truth right now in the name
yes,
of
Lord.
Jesus.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Lord, your word says that your promises are yes and amen.
Yes.
And I believe it, Lord.
Yes.
Your word said it.
Mm.
So, touch him, Lord.
Glory.
Father God, we just plead the blood over his head, Father God, to roll down, Father
yes.
God.
Yes. Mm.
We claim your healing in the name of Jesus right now.
Yes, Lord.
Your guidance and your love.
Yes.
In Jesus' name.
Jesus.
Lord, your word says that many are the afflictions of the righteous, but my God has delivered them. Lord, your word says that I am fearfully and wonderfully made, that you knit me together in my mother's womb, Father. So every organ, Father, in his body, you named, you created, and you made it, Father. So you are the great physician, for your word says that you are Jehovah Rapha, the great healer.
Yes, sir.
So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we declare, we claim, and we rejoice in his healing, Father, that you have already reached down into his prostate, Father God. You have fixed what the world says is wrong. But we know that we have a God who says that
yes,
what the
Lord.
World says is not what I say. And I have the final
yes,
word, for I am the Lord God Almighty, and this is your man, Father. So we thank you for his healing. We give you glory and we rejoice in what you have already done, that you have delivered him from his sickness in Jesus'
name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 I just obey the Holy Spirit. When I hear him, I just say, yes, sir. Amen. But by the way, if they didn't tell you, this is a Jesus church. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And we follow the move of the Holy Spirit, because I still believe in signs and wonders. I still believe in the move of the Holy Spirit. Glory to God. Amen, amen. Beloved, 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 God has given me the assignment in this season to teach a series on prayer. Amen. I believe in this season that God is so good. God is so good. Wait a minute. He convicted me this morning to share my story, knowing that, we probably knew before my mother's womb, he's going to make me preach on prayer. I didn't plan any of this. Then he tells me in the middle of getting ready to preach, knowing I only got 15 minutes, had the ministers come up and pray. God is so good. All the time. So we're going to go into a series of prayer, and I'm going to take it step by step, line upon line, precept upon precept. First, we're going to break down the template that the Lord has given us on how to pray. Then we're going to go into some other areas of prayer, and we're just going to get in this deep, this prayer thing, because the Bible says that the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man changes things. That's what the Bible says. I am convinced that as Christians, we don't love one another enough, and I am convinced as Christians, we don't pray enough. Glory to God. I believe that there are a lot of things that have not taken place, Miss Jennifer, in this world because we ain't prayed about it. We haven't prayed about it. Glory be to God. Amen. Or we're not praying accurately, meaning we're not praying according to the word of God. Because God may not answer what you say, talking about, yes, please, 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 please. But God always responds to his word, because he says, my word shall never return void. Glory be to God. Thank you, Holy Spirit. The Bible says that it's clear, Zach, that some things won't happen until you pray. It says that some things are not removed except by fasting and prayer. It says, I won't heal your land until you humble yourselves and pray. Ladies and gentlemen, we must get our prayer life in check. Jesus says to his disciples, pray in this manner. Jesus is not saying that when we pray that we should recite these words. No, 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 no. Jesus is saying, kneel down on your knees before the Lord and pray in this manner. This is a template. Watch this. Let's talk about it. Because in the template that Jesus gave us, at the beginning, it starts off with a declaration. It's a declaration. Watch this. It's a declaration about God. It says, our Father in heaven. That says three things right away. When Jesus says, our Father in heaven, that says three things right away. First, it says to me that all of us, no matter what, share the same God. We all got the one God, one baptism, one spirit. Hey, so right away when I hear him say, our Father who art in heaven, it makes me understand that we got one God. We got one God. And says to me, our says we in this together. We're in this together. Glory to God. It says our Father. And I like that because I come to know that there's a difference between dad and father. Can we just be real? I mean, we all family, right? Right? We all good. There's a difference between dad and father. Dad created. Father walked down the line with you, nourishing you and protecting you and providing and taking care. Father. And I only say that to get us in the frame of mind when God starts his declaration, he wants you to understand, I'm not talking about some drill sergeant sitting in the sky ready to cut your head off every time you do something wrong. I'm talking about a father who sits high and looks low and is ready to love on you. Glory to God. Our Father. I like that it said our Father because that brings an understanding that as a community of believers, we are family. The problem is we don't treat each other that way. The problem is we don't treat each other that way. I love the fact that God is my Father because as you begin to think about all the nurturing aspects of a good, good Father, you should begin to ascribe those to God. He's my protector, Father. He's my provider, Father. He's my leader, Father. His love is strong and nurturing because God is my Father. Watch this. Let's go to Matthew 7:11. Look at the Bible says. Bible says it's talking about human fathers. So you human fathers, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children. How much more will the Father who is in heaven give good gifts to those who ask? He's such a good Father that he said, I will not withhold no good thing from you. I'm trying to get you in the mindset that at the beginning of your prayer, you have to make a declaration. Who are you talking to? I'm talking to my Father. Now, our Father is in heaven. He's high and lifted up. And that warms my heart to know that when I get to heaven, I'll be there with my Father. Our Father means that we are in relationship with him. In heaven, our Father in heaven. In heaven means, listen to this, in heaven means, watch this, God has the vantage point of the perspective of knowing everything that's going on in your life. Hallowed be his name. The Bible says he sits on the world. He's the CEO of the universe. And the Bible says, before you pray, we begin to declare, to declare, who are you talking to? He says, hallowed be your name. Watch this. I'm talking about the name above every name. In the Old Testament, Eric, his name was so holy that they wouldn't even say his name in their mouth because they felt like just speaking it has disrespected him because it's no way I could call him anything that would bestow the reverence he deserves. Just had to be like, because I didn't want to say nothing that would dismean his glory. That's how reverent they carried his name. Hallowed be his name. Hollow means to hold in reverence. Holy awe. Holy awe. We should revere the presence and the things of God. God is too holy to be treated casually and trivially. I remember one day I was talking to my dad. And I was feeling some type of way. And he's trying to tell me something. And I'm trying to be all such and such and muchy much. I said, man, you trying to tell me about my homie. God's my homie. He said, homie? He said, that sounds just disrespectful to call God homie. And then I'm thinking I'm trying to be real close with God, like a super relationship, but I understood where he's coming from. I had got too casual. You know, because familiarity breeds contempt. So, you know, don't get so comfortable that you forget God is high, lifted high, and he looks low. Don't get so comfortable that you forget you only breathing because God said so. Don't get so comfortable to forget that you only made it here safe because God said it was okay. Don't get so comfortable and forget that you only made it to 75 because God said it was okay. I don't know. Oh, I feel my preach coming on now, Nate. Glory to God. When we worship God, it's not casual endeavors, but it is the one that ought to be filled with reverence. I like when Christine worships, she don't like to be touched. Because she's in such deep reverence with God, she feels like if you touch her, you just interrupted her conversation with God. And to her, she felt like she just disrespected God by stopping in the middle of her reverence to talk to you about whatever you needed to talk about. I like that. I like that. Glory to God. I'm talking about, we're just going through these piece by piece, because I know you've been praying your whole life. I know you've been saved for 40 years, but let me help us. Because here's the thing. The devil has unleashed a genocidal attack upon the world, let alone the body of Christ. A genocidal attack to kill the next generation. So what we have to do as a church is we have to magnify generational blessings. So one of the ways we magnify generational blessings is we have to go back and begin to teach foundational teachings, raising those up who all these people we keep saying, there's 65 people that got saved. Some of them baby Christians. We can't stay way up here. We lose them. And we're only as strong as our weakest link. So we have to teach foundation and build them up so we all be built up. And I'm sorry about y'all on this other end. Ms. Jennifer, I apologize. I promise I'm going to have the air fixed next week. Got my word on it. Glory to God. Amen. Generational blessings. Glory to God. When we talk to God, we need to acknowledge who he is. Can I tell you something? When you pray, before you ask God for anything, you ought to magnify his name. Before you ask God for anything, you got to declare who you're talking to. You got to magnify his name. You got to give him glory. Come on, somebody. I'm teaching us about prayer. You just don't go in God's room and talk about gimme. You go in there saying, God, if you don't do one more thing, you've been good. God, you're mighty and lifted up. God, you're full of mercy and grace. God, you're super. God, you're supreme. God, you almighty. God, thank you for loving me. Father, can I talk to you? Come on. Come on. Now, then Jesus moves on in the prayer, right? And he says, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Jesus moves on in the template and he says, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now, stop right there. Because if you ever really said that out of your mouth and understood what you were saying, then it ought to leap in your spirit, things are gonna get better. Yeah. Come on. If you've ever really understood, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, and you understood those words that came out of your mouth, it ought to leap in your spirit. Things are about to get better. Glory to God. Hey, hey, when Jesus says, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, watch this. He's saying no matter how dark things look now, no matter how dark things look now, they're about to get better. That's what Jesus lifts up when he's teaching us to pray like this. Now, Jesus is petitioning, watch this. Jesus is petitioning the coming of the kingdom. Jesus is petitioning the coming of the kingdom. So Eric the Red, Emmy Red, Emmy Eric, it says Jesus is petitioning the coming of the kingdom. So if Jesus is petitioning the coming of the kingdom, that raises a question, Emmy Red, what's the kingdom? What's the kingdom? Watch this. That word kingdom, Jesus is using that word, and it means basileo. And that refers to not a kingdom of territory, not a kingdom of dirt. When Jesus uses that word kingdom, he's speaking to the authority of God. When Jesus uses the word kingdom, it is a community of people who have surrendered their hearts to a king who reigns and rules over them. That's kingdom. That's the kingdom Jesus is speaking about. So when Jesus says, watch this, when Jesus says the kingdom, when Jesus says the kingdom of God, he's referring to the time when the reign and the rule of God is over all creation, that when every person and everything whom God has created recognizes that he's God and they surrender themselves to the will of God and do what God wants for them in their lives. Now, let me show you. Let me show you. Jesus said, y'all need to understand, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Jesus is so serious about this statement and things getting better, he prayed the same way. He prayed this, let me show you. Let's go to, because if it ain't Bible, let's go to Luke 22. Y'all give me about 15 minutes. Luke 22, 22:41. This is the wrong time to be late with Eric. This is broken. Lord, help me. Give me some grace today. Glory to God. Luke 22:41. Look at how Jesus is praying. Look at what Jesus did. Jesus said, he withdrawn from about a stone's throw. You know, David Wine, he wanted them to see him. You ever think about that? He was stone's throw away means I wanted to steal y'all to still see what I was doing. Watch this. And he knelt down and prayed. Let me say it again. He knelt down and prayed. Jesus was showing reverence to God. He knelt down and prayed. Look what Jesus said in his prayer. He said, Father, if it's your will, take this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Thy will be done. Watch this. Watch this. I got to tell you something. The good news is when you surrender your will unto God's will give you the strength to do that. That's so good. That's so good. That's so good. Because a lot of us, when I say, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, that's me surrendering my will for God's will. That's more than you giving God your whole heart. See, that's good. I gave God my whole heart. But when he's talking about will, he means my whole life. Come on. Will, that means I circumvent everything. It's all yours, God. Will means I surrender my whole life for Jesus' life. Yeah. Now, David Snyder, if we're going to be real, that ain't easy. Because you got to say yes when you feel like saying no. You got to put your hand in your pocket when you feel like you got to be quiet when you want to talk. You You gotta forgive when you just want to say, You gotta give when you think you should be saving. You gotta serve when you tired. You gotta keep praying when you sleepy. You gotta say no to the crowd even though you like them because they got some stuff in your hand in their hands that's bad for you. I like you, but that stuff in your hands is bad for me, so I'm moving around. You see, it's not easy. It's not easy giving up your will. Y'all, we're holy. You know doggone well when we were sinning, everything you did wrong, it wasn't icky. You was not sinning, talking about, that's so nasty, because you wouldn't have still been doing it. God said, the good news is, if you make a decision to give your will up for mine, I'll give you the strength to do it. Let me prove it to you in the Bible. When Jesus said, Lord, I don't want to do this, but not my will, your will be done. Look what he said. Go to Luke 22:43. Look, then it says, then the angels appeared to him from heaven and strengthened him. You see, when you make a decision, not my will, but God's will be done, God sends angels to give you strength to do it. Yes. Glory to God. Jesus said the kingdom of God is when his will is done on earth as his will is done in heaven. Let me say it again. Jesus says the kingdom of God is when his will is done on earth as his will is done in heaven. So now, if we're going to do his will on earth, then we need to know how is his will being done in heaven. Right, Dodie? If he's saying, I need y'all, you, Dodie, I need you to act like you in heaven, then I need to know how they're acting in heaven. So let's talk about it. If God is saying, act like I'm acting in heaven, act like they acting in heaven, then I need to know how they acting in heaven, right? Okay, but wait a minute. If you a really smart Christian, you ought to be asking, but before I answer, before you tell me what they're doing in heaven, God, tell me who they is. Because I might can't identify with them. They might be somebody I'm not. So the first thing we got to do before we understand what they're doing in heaven so we can do it down here, Emmy Red, we got to understand who's that doing it. So let's talk about it. Let's talk about it. Who are the constituents in heaven? Who are the constituents in heaven? Because we need to identify. If we're going to emulate heaven, we have to identify with the people in heaven. You ready? Who's in heaven? You ready? Angels and the redeemed of the Lord. The two categories in heaven is angels and the redeemed of the Lord. Now watch this. I'm glad that God revealed to us that in heaven is angels and the redeemed of the Lord. You know why I'm glad that he said the constituency in heaven was angels and the redeemed of the Lord? Because now I can identify. Because guess what? On earth, I'm the redeemed of the Lord. You see, on earth, I'm the redeemed of the Lord. So now I can identify. Right? Right? I can identify. The Bible says, let the redeemed. So I got a bunch of people in here can identify with the people in heaven. Okay, let's move on. All right. Jesus has redeemed us on earth, right? So now we have to ask ourselves, then if we are the redeemed down here, and down here is supposed to be like up there, what are they doing up there? What are the redeemed doing up there? Okay, let's talk about it. What are the redeemed doing up there? Because there ought to be some heaven on earth. There ought to be some heaven on earth. Because hear me now. If we're praying for the kingdom to come and that there be some heaven on earth, then his will must be done on earth as it is in heaven. So I need to know what the redeemed are doing concerning the will of God in heaven, because that's what we got to do. On earth as it is in heaven. So how do we do the will of God? Let's talk about how they're doing the will of God in heaven, because it's directly related to how we do the will of God on earth. Number one, How are they doing the will of God in heaven? Obediently. Obediently. The redeemed and the angels are doing the will of God obediently. How about you? Okay. Number two, immediately. The redeemed and the angels in heaven are doing the word of God, the will of God, immediately. How about us? Okay, let's go. Let's move on, Miss Jennifer. Let's get them. Because I like what Miss Jennifer, her terminology, because what he used, what Miss Jennifer uses, is there's no gray area. There's no gray area. It's all black. Right? Y'all ain't holy. Y'all thinking pigmentation. I'm talking about something totally different. I'm talking about ain't no if middle ground. Okay? All right, watch this. Watch this. Number three. Joyfully. Watch this. The angels and the redeemed in heaven are doing the will of God joyfully. How about us? How about us? Okay, number four. The angels and the redeemed in heaven are doing the will of God voluntarily. How about us? How about us? Okay, I'm gonna be on your street in a minute. Just hold on. Just hold on. The angels and the redeemed in heaven are doing the will of God willingly. How about us? Okay. I hate when a person say to me, I got to go to church. I got to go to Bible study. No, you get to go to church. You get to go to Bible study. You get to give. It's a privilege. It's an honor. Number six. With the right heart. Are we doing the will of God with the right heart? Number seven. Are we doing the will of God without question? Because the angels and the redeemed in heaven are doing the will of God without question. Come on, how about us? How about us? The mother brought to my attention earlier, she said, and they're doing the will of God completely. They don't stop halfway. Okay, now watch this, my Bible scholars. Watch this, Ms. Doty. Did you notice how Jesus instructed us to pray that God's will be done on earth before he instructed us to ask for anything? Well, Wait a minute, Misty. Jesus first took us through a declaration. You know who you're talking to. Then he took us to behavioral instructions, saying, I need you to act like the people acting in heaven. Could it be that Jesus was positioning us before we could get answered prayer? Oh. Some of us, yeah, the answer to our prayers is yes and amen, but we over there on 35th Street, and God said the blessing is on 25th. You got to get over here. Could it be that Jesus is positioning our lives to receive what's already ours? Oh, okay. That's good. I'm gonna let y'all sit with that for a minute, because before he said ask him anything, he started telling us how to be in position. Okay. Jesus wants earth to look like heaven. That's the kingdom of God. When we do the will of God, when we obey God's commandments, when we live according to God's word, when we treat each other like Jesus treats us, when we love each other as God desires, that's when the kingdom has come. Can I tell you something? Earth is a dress rehearsal for heaven. George, some of these people gonna be uncomfortable in heaven. Because when you get to heaven, you got to open your mouth and give God glory. And they sitting around talking about, I wasn't doing that down there. Some of us are going to be uncomfortable in heaven. Because when you get to heaven, you got to love your neighbor whether you like them or not. Ain't no, because all they doing is loving. So, you know, when we get to heaven, some of us might be a little uncomfortable. Because in heaven, you don't have to do all the stuff that the world does to get the good stuff. It's already yours. You don't even know how to act. You'll be up there stealing grapes. Yeah. And Jesus is like, man, they're already yours. What you doing? You in heaven. Glory to God. Now watch this. It says, when you pray, pray like this. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That statement is doing three things. That statement is telling us to do three things. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's telling us three things. Let me break them down to you. Number one, it's telling us we pray like this. You acknowledge that there is a better way. Thy kingdom is coming. That is literally you saying and acknowledging there is a better way. There is better coming. Thy kingdom come. Okay, watch this. Watch this. The reason why Jesus kept magnifying kingdoms because there are other kingdoms, guys. Watch this. Watch this. There are other kingdoms and powers in this world. Oh, some people have surrendered to different powers and different kingdoms in this world. When Jesus taught the disciples this prayer, he knew that Rome had a kingdom. The Sanhedrin Council had a kingdom. Satan had a kingdom. And there are those who have surrendered their hearts to Satan, which is contrary to the rule of God. The reason the world is so messed up. The reason the world is so messed up and so many people are hurting and so much disease and so much disaster is because there are some people in the world who have surrendered themselves to something other than the kingdom of God. Think about it. In heaven ain't no disease. In heaven ain't no disaster. Ain't no cancer in heaven. So how is it down here? Because somebody has let it in. Somebody has surrendered to something other than the kingdom of God. Oh, I'm trying to help us. I'm trying to help us. Can I tell you something? So you don't be looking at me so holy? If you have not surrendered to the kingdom of God, by default you surrender to Satan. I know that's tough. I know that's tough. I know that's tough teaching. If you have not surrendered to the will of God, you're by default surrendering to the will of Satan. That's strong, but Jesus said, here we go again, Ms. Black, Ms. Jennifer, ain't no gray areas. Jesus says, it's all black. You either for me or you against me. There is no in between. You either for me or you against me. There is no in between. Glory be to God. I got to preach it like I feel it now, y'all. But the good news is, God intended for us to have some heaven on earth. Yes, he did. Yes, he did. Yeah, I can prove it to you. I can prove it to you. I can prove that my God it meant for me to have some heaven on earth, Zach. Look at John 10:10. He says, whatever Satan came to do, he said, check it out, Zach. But I came that you might have life and life more abundantly. God meant for us to have some heaven. Oh, that wasn't good enough. I heard about three claps. Let me give you one more. Then let's go to Psalm 16:11. I bet this will get you. Look at what Psalm 16:11 says. It says, in his presence is the fullness of joy. Watch this. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Let's get this out of your mind. All pleasures is not sinful. There's some stuff you supposed to do with your wife. It's legal. Oh, they too holy, David. I'm trying to help them. That God has put some, look at your wife and say, God put me some heaven on earth. Oh, there you go. Okay. Okay, I'm patching some stuff up right now. Somebody came in here at odds. I already patched some stuff up. Y'all ought to send me a text. Thank you, Pastor. Jesus says there's no other kingdom at work. Jesus says there is another kingdom at work on earth, and it's the kingdom of God. There is a better word. There is a better way. There is a better way. I got a word for somebody today. I gave it to first service, and I felt like it was about 14 people. But God didn't tell me it was for 14 people. He just said, tell them that I got a word for them. Because I'm sick and tired of people running around the church talking about I got a word for you. I got a word from God, and you ain't accurate. Stop that. Stop that. I'd rather you be late with your word and you be sure than run around telling people I got a word from the Lord and the God ain't told you that. And then you hurt people. And then you mess yourself up for God able to use you. Because once you tell me you got a word from the Lord and it ain't from God, everything you say is suspect from here on out. I had a lady tell me one day, Pastor, I got a word from the Lord. I said, okay, what is it? She said, God told me to tell you, you're going to marry such and such. I looked at her and said, you a lie. God ain't told you that. She said, well, yes, he did. I said, okay. 3 weeks later, the lady left the church. So I'm looking at the lady who told me that, saying, don't you ever tell me again what God said. Be careful with that thus says the Lord stuff. You got to be accurate with that. I'm trying to help us. I'm trying to help us. I don't know how I got there, but I got a word for somebody today. God told me to tell somebody today that if you walk in faithfulness and you know how to pray, he will bless you with grace and mercy and honor your life with blessings. That's for about 8 people in here. 2 of them sitting right there. Let me tell them again, because it's for 2 of them right there. God says, if you walk in faithfulness and you know how to pray, he will bless you with grace and mercy and honor your life with blessings. Number two, real quick, we got to go. You must be assured of its arrival. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. When you pray, you must be assured of its arrival. You must be assured of its arrival. Watch this. Real quick, wake your neighbor up because we're getting ready to go. Look at your neighbor and tell him, tell your neighbor, it's on the way. It's on the way. Watch this. Whatever God is doing, it's already in motion. It's already in motion. Hey, it may not be complete yet, but it's in motion. It's already in motion. Somebody ought to say amen to that. God, the Lord will deliver his will in your life. The Lord will deliver his will in your life. When Jesus made his appearance, he was literally starting the clock on Satan. Saying, I'm on my way. He doesn't have power and authority over you no more. Because Jesus, and in Jesus, the kingdom of God can operate now on earth as it is in heaven. Watch this. If you got an Instagram or you got a tweet, you need to tweet this. Tweet this. Instagram this. Watch this. This is worth all the gas it took you to get here, buddy. Watch this right here. The incarnation is the initiation of the restoration of the kingdom of God. That's so good. The incarnation is the initiation of the restoration of the kingdom of God. Oh, that's so good right there. That's so good right there. Glory to God. Jesus, the incarnation is the initiation of the restoration of the kingdom of God. Jesus, because of Jesus, the last can be first. Because of Jesus, I can pour, say I'm rich. Because of Jesus, the sick can say I'm healed. Because of Jesus, the low can be lifted up. Glory to God. Number three, we got to go home. Number three, act in anticipation of his arrival. Act in anticipation of his arrival. Watch this. When you pray, you're sowing a seed. Amen. Anybody ever sowed a seed? And my rancher's over here, homestead. Anybody ever sowed a seed and didn't water that? You went back, it was brown, and it was dead. A lot of us are praying, we're sowing seeds, but we're not rerouting and watering it. What are you talking about, Pastor? When you sow a seed, you have to water it with your faith. Your faith is the water. The Bible says one man sows, another man waters, and God grows. So if you sow a seed and you water it with your faith, God will grow it. How do I act with anticipation? David Snyder, you're looking for a house? You got to act with anticipation. I didn't say just pray. I said act now. What does that mean? When you hear in your spirit, Julia, that it's God saying you got a house, start packing. Yeah. Literally. Start putting stuff in boxes. What you doing? Oh, we gone. Can I tell you a story? Let me give you a real true story. I got to wrap it up. When I got ready to get my house, real story. The Lord told me, woke me up in the middle of the night, and I thought he was telling me about a sermon to preach. He was saying, pack your bags, it's time to go. I thought he was giving me a sermon to preach. So I'm up, and I'm writing it down, and I'm preaching. I went and got every suitcase in the house. I got them on my shoulders. I'm running around the living room, so I'm pack my bags. But I was so excited I couldn't hear. But he was telling me, I got a house for you. So he said to me, I need you to do two things. He said, number one, I need you to sow an uncommon seed. And number two, I need you to pack your bags. I said, wait a minute, God, I don't even have a house, I don't got a loan, nothing. What are you talking about? He said, sow an uncommon seed and pack your bags. I sowed an uncommon seed that Sunday. And I went to my garage, and I start packing up stuff, throwing away stuff. I ain't used this in 5 years. It's gone. Start packing up stuff. What you doing? I'm getting ready. So now watch this. So then after I got about seven boxes packed, I meet this lady overhearing her talking at the grocery store about this program through NAGOG. N-A-G, how you pronounce it? NAGOG. What is it? NAGOG. Right? That the NACOG will pay $20,000 if you're a first-time buyer. I overhear him talking about it. I sign up for the program. I get it. I get $20,000. I go to the bank. She said, how much you got? I said, NACOG said, I got 20. So she checks into it. I got the program. Now, mind you, all I did was pack seven boxes, so I got the program. So now I'm going to show you how God will test your faith. The devil will mess with you when you really step out. Be careful. The devil will mess with you when you really step out. So my box is packed. I got the loan because I got $20,000. And they said to me that I think it was 90 days or was it 60 days for the loan. 60 days. I had 60 days that I had to find the house. Or the loan expires, you got to do it all over again. You with me? You with me? Real story, Ms. Jennifer, going to blow you away. So I'm looking. Every time I find a house, somebody outbid me. I'm looking. Every time I find a house, somebody get it. I'm looking. Dang it, California people, they got it. I'm just kidding. I'm kidding. So I couldn't get a house. Watch this. On the 59th day, the 59th day, Miss Jennifer, I'm done. The real estate lady was like, well, she already talking to me about, well, you know, it ain't gonna be that bad. If they qualified you once, they'll qualify you again. I think NACOG will still be there. 59th day. It's 3:00. I see a house. She negotiating with the guy about who pays the closing cost and some of the other situations, because now ain't been no home inspection. So now we trying to work all that out. He texts back and said, just forget it. You know, I don't want to rush into this. Let's just wait, right? So watch this. It's 6:00. The 59th day, my realtor calls me back and says, I think he wants to do it. He just texts me back and says, you know what? I feel like I need to sell this guy this house. She said, let's get this done. I said, well, what you need me to do? She says, let me put some things together because Bank of America is closed. It's 6:00. We messing around. She trying to get to the escrow companies. And now, watch this, Ms. Jennifer. It's 7:15 at night. It's dark. The real estate agent called me on the phone. She says, hey. Okay, here I come, girls. She says, hey, I got a plan. What is it? She says, I got a friend. She's the manager of Bank of America in Phoenix. And I got a friend who owns an escrow company. I'm coming to pick you up. I said, wait, what? She said, I'm coming to pick you up. I'm telling y'all the real story. So, because I stepped out on faith, right? She picked me up. Now it's 7:45. I'm in my driveway. She picked me up. It's nighttime. And I'm looking at her as we drive and like, you know what? This better be right. We get to Phoenix. It's 8:40 at night. We talking back and forth with the manager of Bank of America. It's 8:40 at night. She tell the Bank of America lady, she said, hey, I really want to get this done for this guy. So does the owner. She said, can I please come over to your house? She said, for you, come. We went to the bank manager's. I know Jennifer talked about this is all out of boundaries. You just broke every rule. We went to the bank manager's house. She in her pajamas and house shoes. It's nighttime, Dre. We in the driveway. We got a flashlight and we holding it over the paperwork. Signing in her driveway at night with a flashlight. That ain't all. So then I got to go to the escrow company. She waked the escrow company up. Said, would you please go back to your office? She said, if you really think it's for him, I'll come back. She comes back to the escrow office. Now it's 10:00 at night. I'm in the escrow office and we panicking because it's got to be done before 12 midnight. So look what she doing to me, Miss Jennifer. She flipping through the pages. She already got them tagged. So she flipping through the pages like this. Sign right here. Sign right here. Now I'm nervous in my stomach now because I ain't read nothing. I'm just signing. And she looked at me and I was like, wait, miss. I feel some type of way. I need to read something. She looked at me and said, what? You mean to tell me after all we've been through, you got to read it? And I'm like, yeah. So I kind of was trying to speed read, right? Like, and she flipping it. And right about 8:20, we email everything. I mean, we fax everything. And now we just hoping and praying. And the next day, we get a text. On the 60th day, the house is yours. I just told you a real story. You ain't even got to go to TBN. Glory to God. Don't tell me what God won't do when you step out on faith. Give God glory in this place. Come on up, ushers. 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 I feel like somebody in here was waiting just till we get to the end. I feel like somebody in here was waiting just till we get to the end so they can come up and be saved. I feel like somebody in here was waiting till we get to the end so they can come up and be saved. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Let's go to a scripture on giving, and we got to get out of here. We got to go baptize. Look what the Bible says. Since we're talking about the will of God, look what the Bible says. The Bible says, if God will, we're talking about the will of God, if God will indeed be with me, protect me on this journey, if he will provide me with food and clothing, and if he will return me safely to my house, then the Lord will certainly, his will, be my God. I don't know. Has anybody ever been protected by the Lord? Has anybody ever been fed by the Lord? Okay, did you eat breakfast this morning? Okay. I see everybody got clothes on, right? He says, and I gave you clothes. Stop right there. He wasn't talking about the shirt and pants on your body. God says, if I clothes you, he's talking about being clothed in his righteousness. God's not talking about your shirt. He's talking about everybody in here, no matter how holy you are. Your righteousness is a filthy rag. And it's because of Jesus that we're clothed in righteousness. God says, if I've clothed you in righteousness, watch this. The Lord says, certainly he'll be my God. He says, and then this memorial pillar I will have set up will become a place of worship. And I will present to God a tenth of everything he gives me. I just wonder if anybody appreciates that God has a will to provide for you. God has a will to protect you. God has a will to feed you. God has a will to clothe you. I just wonder if anybody can appreciate that will to a point that they would make a vow in their will to give a tenth of what they have. Now, I don't know, that's just Bible, but I believe the Bible. Anybody else believe the Bible? Yes. It's time to give, Mount Zion. We didn't work them over. Let's worship our way out, God. Let's get out of here and go baptize.
That is broken. Great are you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
You give life, you are love, you bring life.